All right, hello. My name is Andreas Kunz. I'm working at SAP in the UI5 development area as an architect. And I've been with UI5 from the very beginning, in end 2008, beginning 2009. I've been in the core team, developing controls, now more doing this Web ID application templates or tutorial stuff, more rollout stuff, so I've seen all areas. I've also written lots of controls, like 20 or 30 of the controls you are using have originally been written by me. So now I'm trying to pack some of this knowledge into these 30 minutes. I could speak an entire week about controls, but yeah, let's see what we can do in these 30 minutes to give you an impression what you can do with custom controls that you develop on your own. So maybe one question in the beginning. Who of you has already created a custom control, no matter how complex? Well, like half of them?
Copy-paste.
yeah, it does. Copy-paste counts. Or who has not ever written a control? Okay. And the rest is just too tired to raise your hands? Okay. All right. So you don't look like you need any motivation, but I still have some additional motivation. So this is how your UI5 application could look. It's actually an SAP product. It's SubSports 1. There's also YouTube advertising videos about it, so you can get public information about it. I also have an I have a live version of this application. For example, it provides video recordings of games for trainers of the team, so trainers can analyze certain scenes, can look for key scenes like a goal scored by Mario Götze. Then we have here a scene, we can jump to this scene and we can watch this goal developing and stuff. So this is one thing. Another thing is for the physiotherapists. It doesn't look like a goal just yet, but it will come, I promise you. It's like a minute in advance. And yeah, this is just to tell you what you can do with custom controls. So these applications, this application has been written mostly with custom controls. Okay, that was the goal. And yeah, so let's go back to the presentation. Now you're motivated, right? So in UI5, basically when you see it on the screen in the UI5 application, then it's a control. Of course, you can also write custom HTML, but usually all the stuff on the screen, whether it is a simple Hello World button or it's a huge Goat Reflection UX3 shell, that's all controls. So everything that is rendered, displayed, is done with a control. UI5 contains a lot of controls. I'm standing on the screen here. So OpenUI5 has 270 controls. The entire SubUI5 package has more than 500. So this is also counting some base classes that are not so really usable, but there is a lot of controls inside UI5 still. There's often the need to do something on your own because they don't exactly cover your use case. Okay, let's start with the basics. So control consists logically of three different parts. So one is the control API. That's the properties, events, aggregations, associations, so everything that is the interface of the control to the application, so how you can interact with the control. Then we have a renderer part. The renderer part is responsible for creating the HTML. So it creates the structure of the control, everything that is visible. Of course, the CSS for the styling also belongs to this visibility part. And the third area is the what we call the behavior. That's all the JavaScript code that handles user interactions or any logic inside the control. So more or less, this is like a model view controller in a very small package. Or if we look more at an object class hierarchy, then every control inherits from SubUI core control. And this inherits initially from SubUI base object, which is the base class of all UI5 objects, of all UI5 classes. Event provider inherits from object. Event provider has the capability of firing events, attaching to events, attach event, detach event, that's all coming from event provider. Then we have managed object inheriting from event provider. This is, I think, the most powerful class in this hierarchy. This is adding all the properties, aggregation stuff, and all the data binding. So that's all happening here in the managed object. class from which element inherits. Element is already related to something on the UI, but elements do not have a renderer on their own usually. So elements are like things like list items, so sub-UI core list items in a drop-down box. So these are elements. They are rendered by a parent control. And finally, we have the control class from which all the controls inherit. So if you develop your own control, you should inherit from control and or from some specific control and go ahead from there. Okay, that was enough talk without code. Let's go to the code. I have prepared an example, a pretty old one. You might have seen it already. That's a simple square control. I'm loading, or I'm trying to load from JSBin. You know JSBin, I guess, that's just an online tool where you can write code at the left and immediately see the output at the right. And these examples are, of course, available publicly. The slides contain all the links. Zoom in a bit so you can read it well. So you inherit from the base class control that I've just mentioned. You say sub-UI core control extend, then give the name of your control, of your new control, which in this case should be a square with a text inside, and then you are ready to go. So first define the control API. That's this metadata section here, where we currently just have two properties. So we have a text, which is of type string, that should be displayed inside the square, and we have the size, where we have given the type sub-UI core CSS size. So this defines like 200 pixels, 500% or something. And UI5, when you give a type to a property, make sure that only valid values are set. Otherwise, there's an exception. Okay, second part after defining the API is the renderer. The renderer is a static function where you get in an instance of the control, this O control here, and the so-called render manager. The render manager is a tool that collects HTML snippets, so you piece together the HTML strings here, and this render manager collects all of them and later on puts them into the HTML document. So when we render the square, we want to have a div tag. It's opened here and it's closed at the very end. And inside the div tag, we first write some management data for UI5. That's the write control data call here. Then we add some styles. For example, we read the size of the control. We just have defined the size property above, and UI5 automatically generates the get size and set size, get text, set text. All these accessor methods are automatically generated when we have defined them here. So we can say get size and get the size of the square control and add it as a width and height style. Add some CSS class for the styling, and finally we close this tag, and inside the tag we write the text. And we do this with write escape because we want to avoid cross-site scripting attacks. The text of the control has not been defined as a certain pattern, but it can be any string. There could be even JavaScript code inside. So we have to say write escaped here to avoid cross-site scripting. And finally, we have some event handling. So when the user clicks the square, then there should be an alert box displaying the text. And that's all. So that's like 25, 30 lines of code, and you have your own control. And it can be used like any other control. You just say new my.square, like you would say my new sub and button or so. Give the text property, give a size, place at content, and you see it at the right. There's this hello square. When I click it, you see this alert box. Same for the second one, the me too square alerts me too. So if you go to the Chrome Developer Tools and arrange it so you can see something actually, and inspect the HTML, you see that's what we've just written. So there's a div with some management information of UI5, the width and height that we have written in the renderer, an additional class, and the text that we have written inside the div. So that's how you can easily track the stuff that you write in the renderer to the HTML. But I guess a square is not a very exciting control, so let's go to something a bit more complex. that would be a Google map. This is defined just the same way. Let me zoom out a bit. You don't need to read all the code now, just to get a feeling of the size of the code and the general pattern. Again, we have control extend at the top. Now we define a my.google map. We have again properties. In case of a map, it's of course something else. It would be latitude, longitude, and a zoom factor. These are the properties that our map should have. The renderer is down here, so we just create some div where the Google APIs can later on render their content. So it's just a container. Actually, there's one more container inside, which we create here with the SAPUI Core HTML control, which is rendered inside. So this is just a shell for Google to render their stuff. And in this case, after the first rendering, we need to do some things. We need to instantiate the Google map. It's a new Google Maps.map here. And we want to listen to some events. So when the user moves the map, the center changes. Or when the user changes the zoom factor in the map, then we want to be notified in the UI5 control. So we can update the properties of the control. So in this case, we set the longitude property to what we get from Google and the latitude, or the same with the zoom factor. So whatever the user does in the map will be reflected in the data of our control. And to display this control, we just do the same thing, my.google map. In this case, we don't set a longitude, but we bind it to a model. So we have defined a model above here, a JSON model, where we have a longitude, a latitude, and a zoom factor. And we use data binding here, so the Google map is bound to these, to this data. This enables us to add some more controls down here, some sliders that are bound to the same data in the model. So we want to try some data binding here, because the data binding for custom controls comes out of the box. So you see this, I should zoom out a bit so you in the back rows can also see it. So at the bottom there are some sliders. I zoom out some more because you're looking like you don't see it. So there are sliders at the bottom. And when I move these sliders, the map will react. This is because of the data binding. So I zoom out a lot and you see the map reacts through data binding. Or, of course, we have two-way data binding in UI5. If I move the map, you see the sliders moving at the bottom. And, you know, we haven't done anything in the control definition to allow data binding. This is coming all out of the box. So it's pretty easy to develop a pretty powerful, impressive control with this UI5 control development. One more thing that also works out of the box is the support tool. So who of you knows the control Alt, Shift, and S pop-up? Really should. So all fingers plus S, we like support. That's a support pop-up that gives some insight about the current application.
How do you do this on Mac?
On Mac, it's one of these Mac-specific keys. I don't have a Mac, sorry, but try S plus all the keys you have. And let's just open this in a new window, and then we see the support tool in action. Control Alt Shift and S. So that's this UI5 diagnostics support tool, which offers lots of information about versions, modules that are loaded, and so on. It allows now, Stefan has mentioned it this morning, also to do some performance and interaction performance measurements. This is still being developed, so it's not fully done yet, I would say. And that's also the control tree. And inside this control tree, you see all the controls in the application. And even this Google map we have just developed is a full member of this control hierarchy. The support tool recognizes this Google map control and can display information about it. So it has the latitude, longitude, all the data, all the properties. You see the data binding. You can also modify the data here. Let's go somewhere else. Or zoom out. So all this functionality is automatically working when you are defining a control like this. Now you may wonder, how does it work that I click the slider and the map above does that something? What's happening behind the scenes? So now let's take a small deep dive into UI5. A technical one for those who know already a bit about controls, I guess. Let's just check what happens. Let's go to the debugger. So that's where the truth happens, I guess. We have the map control we have just defined, and we have this renderer. And let's just set a breakpoint in the renderer. And click something like the latitude slider at the very left. Yeah, okay, we see there is some rendering happening. What's going on? Let's analyze the stack. Go all the way down to what happens here. At the very bottom, there is some event stuff going on. Okay, if the user clicks somewhere, there's some event handling. Mouse to touch handler. UI5 simulates mouse events from touch events and vice versa. So you as an application or control developer don't have to care about what the user is currently using. Okay, then there is handle event. UI5 does the event handling for the most important events and dispatches it to the controls. Go further up the stack. Slider on touch start. Oh, the slider developer has developed an on touch start method where he checks, oh, where has the user touched or pressed the slider, and then calculates what the value on this slider range is and sets the value. So when the slider is touched, the value of the location is calculated and the slider sets the value. Then we go to manage object. The managed object manages all the properties, I said. So we have managed object set property, and it also handles the data binding. So there's update model property. And the JSON model where we have bound the data to notices, oh, there's a change in my data. So we should do something. And what should we do? Wait, there's a timeout. So first, wait, maybe there might be more changes. We don't want to handle every single change, but we want to collect them. So we wait for 0 milliseconds, which means wait until JavaScript processing has finished and then immediately do the next steps. Okay, after all the model changes have arrived, we go again to the model. The model checks what has changed finally. Maybe something has changed and changed back or so. So it calculates what has changed. And it finds, okay, here the latitude or longitude has changed. And there's something else bound to it. So it finds here, check update. It finds something needs to be informed. So it fires an event. We come to the manage object update property. And that's now the Google Map manage object. So not the slider anymore, but we have now arrived via the model to the Google Map. The map is informed that something has changed. The data binding sets the property. So this property is the latitude, which you see here. So Google Map knows latitude needs to change. A change in the control means by default that there's some invalidation because control different data needs to be re-rendered. It needs to display the new state. So UI5 will collect all this information. Okay, there is something invalidated. We need to re-render it. And again, we wait. Because there could be another control that also needs re-rendering. We want to do it all together. Or the same control could be modified multiple times. And we don't want to re-render it multiple times. So that's optimization. Again, wait 0 milliseconds. So just wait until everything else is done. And then UI5 starts again. Render all the pending UI updates. In this case, of course, it's just the Google Map. UI5 calls the render manager, the render manager renders the control, and finally we are back at the code we have just written in JSPN, and the rendering is triggered. So this is how the slider click triggers through the entire UI5 stack, triggers our renderer in the control. That's a bit of a fast deep dive for more the hardcore people of you, but you can like replay the recording in slow motion or something. And for your convenience, I also have a sort of overview in the slides. But this is basically the entire magic of data binding, invalidation, re-rendering in UI5. So this is really hardcore core stuff. I think you can get rid of this. So in case I lost you, this slide repeats the stuff. So it marks the most important things that are happening and lists what UI5 is doing here. So a re-rendering of the entire control might not always be what you want. So it sounds a bit scary, like I change the text and the entire control is recreated from scratch. Actually, it's pretty fast. So when I drag the slider of the map, or below the map, you didn't really see that the map was completely recreated all the time. And so you can have 60 frames per second when re-rendering an entire screen. But when there are tables or when you have a container control that contains a lot of complex stuff, then you don't want the entire container and all the content to be re-rendered when just the title of something changes. And in this case, you can do something and it can override the generic setters, like set latitude that are generated. I mean, not generic, so you can override the generated setters and implement it on your own. So in this case, you take the latitude, the new one coming in, we have to set the to persist the property, so it's called set property latitude, that's the setter in manage object, to store the value, the new value, and this is the key point here, give an additional parameter true. This means suppress the re-rendering. So this means, dear UI5, you're cool, but I want to update the HTML, don't do all this re-rendering stuff. And of course, this is what we have to do now. We check whether the map has already been rendered at all. And then we call the Google Map. So this dot underscore map is the Google Map JavaScript instance. And we just tell Google Map pan to the position we now have. So no re-rendering, just tell Google Maps to have some nice animation to the new position. This avoids the entire re-rendering and it gets smoother and faster.
So,
good question. Return this is just for chaining actually. So every setter of your UI5 controls, you can just call set latitude dot set something else dot set something else. This avoids the need to repeat the map dot set latitude map dot do something. So it's just a convention that we always return this when there's nothing else that we could reasonably return. So programming is a bit easier with this fluent, values. So I have already prepared an example where we just have this one additional method and maybe you are able to spot the difference. Zoom out a bit. And we have only overridden or added the latitude handler here to avoid the re-rendering. So when I click longitude, a different longitude, you see it jumps to the next place. If I press latitude, you see there's some animation. It's a bit subtle, but it shows you, you could also debug it, of course. There's no re-rendering, that's now handled by the Google Maps API. And how did the support tool notice what's going on with the Google Map? How did it recognize it? How was it able to display the properties? That's because we have this management information, the ID of the map written to the HTML, and then UI5 can notice, okay, this is the ID, there's the HTML belonging to it, it has the connection between the HTML and the JavaScript object. So UI5 can get the control instance, this crazy thing, and inspect it, and can say get metadata. You can call get metadata on any control, and you get a lot of information about it. For example, the name. That's the class name. So UI5 knows, oh, that's a Google Map. Okay, nice thing. And you can also inspect the properties. With get properties, you get a map of all the properties, and for example, the latitude. And you get all kinds of meta information about this latitude property. For example, the type, a default value, if anything is defined, and so on. So that's how you or UI5 or anyone can inspect the controls, even the custom controls. So when you are implementing the controls, I've talked already about the renderer method and about some event handler methods. There's also on init, on exit. These are like when the control is instantiated or when it's destructed, you can do some cleanup or some initialization. There's on before rendering and after rendering. These are called right before or right after the renderer method. In case, again, you want to clean up something, remove some custom event handlers or add some event handlers or do some size adaptations after the rendering or so. So most events can be just handled in your control by writing on something like on click in the square we have seen. You have 5 registers already handlers at the root element for all the important events, but for some it doesn't. So there's a list behind this link here. For some it doesn't, and then you can just use the normal jQuery.on or jQuery bind to bind your own event handlers. For mouse move, for example, we don't register because it's fired all the time. All right. So this is just a 30-minute session. In 1 hour, I would go to all these examples and explain some more stuff in depth, but you still have the links. Here you would see a square that is implemented also firing an event. We have already talked about the rendering, so one important thing to repeat is really when you write your own controls, do escape all the plain strings where you don't know what the content is because of cross-site scripting. And yeah, controls always have one root node and you have to use this write control data. So we have the ID of the control in the DOM and we can find the control to re-render it, to dispatch events to it and so on. Yeah, there's also an example about the square as a container control. It's very easy. Do we have time for this? Almost, yeah. I think we can manage this. So to enable your new control to have controls inside to create a container control, you just have to define an aggregation, which is just done like the properties above. You say an aggregation. Oh, sorry. Let's call up an aggregation named content, and the type is control. So we can have any control inside. You could limit it to buttons or so, but here it's just a generic container control. In the renderer, you can then access this aggregation. So when after you have written the text, you say control get content. That's just an array of the controls inside. You loop over this content, and for every content control, you say render manager render control, give the control inside, and everything inside happens automatically. So you don't care about whether it's a button or whether it's a shell or something inside. And yeah, this can be used just like all the aggregations, just put some content inside. The CSS for such controls, you can just put it into the HTML document or load it in your application like I have done. If you do more serious control development with reuse across different applications, I would suggest that you really build control libraries. This is a bit more powerful. You have also less the CSS preprocessor, access to other color parameters in our CSS files. You can have different themes automatically supported. So the instructions for creating control libraries are at this link to GitHub. It's not really hard, but you need the grunt build for these libraries. But of course, if you develop your own controls, you need to think about accessibility. So screen reader support, you need additional properties, helping a screen reader to describe your control for blind people. Maybe there's need for keyboard interactions, special keys or so. You want to support the high contrast black theme, maybe. You could also want to write pop-up controls. There's also an example where the square is a pop-up. There's just a helper class. It's pretty easy. And of course, you should also, yeah, think about tests. Final slide. I have 12 seconds left. The documentation is, of course, in the demo kit, in the SDK. there are some things here. Developing content is the entry point where we have all stuff that is like extending UI5 with additional controls. How are controls developed? What are some guidelines we have for control development? There's also one walkthrough step. The walkthrough, if you haven't done it, is really recommended. There's one step about custom controls. Then the GitHub documentation about control libraries I have just mentioned. And of course, in these slides, there's also some content that is never documented anywhere so far. And so with a beep, I guess I thank you for your attention and hope you got some inspiration what you could do and how you could do your own controls. Thanks.